Springfield's drinking water source had elevated levels of haloacetic acids in December 2018. When it comes to drinking water safety, this is one of those compounds the State Department of Public Health keeps its eye on. To find out what caused this and whether the water is safe to drink, I spoke with University of Massachusetts Amherst environmental engineering professor David Reckhow and Josh Schimmel, the executive director of Springfield's Water and Sewer Commission.
We were required to give a public notification to all of our customers about an exceedance of haloacetic acids in the water supply. And so haloacetic acids are a regulated substance as part of the drinking water program in the state of Massachusetts. And because of that exceedance, we gave the notice. Haloacetic acids are a reaction between dissolved organic materials naturally occurring in the environment and with the chlorination of the drinking water. And they form and they can persist throughout the distribution system and end up coming through the tap.
Professor, frame for us the potential impact that these haloacetic acids can have on public health.
Right. Well, I'm not a toxicologist or an epidemiologist. I'm an environmental engineer. But from my understanding of what we know, the haloacetic acids and the related disinfection byproducts, the trihalomethanes, have both been proposed as potential carcinogens. And we know from the epidemiological studies that have been done around the world that there's an association between drinking chlorinated tap water that contains these compounds and elevated levels of bladder cancer. There are some other endpoints too, health endpoints, that might or might not be related. And those include such things as low birth weight, newborns, and spontaneous abortion. But the connection like this doesn't necessarily always mean causality. In other words, these compounds are present in the water. They may not be the ones that are causing the health problem.
It could be some other compound that we're not testing for or something like that.
Right.
But for now, we watch them because of the potential of this happening. So the state mandates 60 parts per billion or less of these in Springfield, as I understand it from the testing. It was sort of mid-60s to the 66 parts per billion range. How much of this water would we actually have to drink to potentially see some kind of harm?
Well, you need a lifetime of this water, in fact, day in, day out, 24/7 for 60 years or more.
So if in the last month or two you've been consuming the water, you see that there's a reporting of these elevated levels, you don't immediately need to be alarmed.
No, not at all.
And I think that speaks to the public notice requirement is public notice had to be out within 30 days. Had this been an immediate concern, public notice has to go out within 24 hours, and certainly we would do that.
And given that this is kind of a combination of something that not only Springfield, but lots of communities do, add chlorine to the water as a safety measure, and then the water itself is kind of reacting with the chlorine, right? Is Springfield the only place that might see something like this going on?
Certainly not. I think this is being experienced across the entire region and in western Massachusetts in particular. But we really see a correlation between all the rain from midsummer through the fall is having an impact on organics kind of going into the drinking water reservoir. And those organics are what react with the chlorinated water.
And have you made any shifts to adding less chlorine or changing what you're putting into the water?
Yeah, I mean, water treatment shifts every day, right? So we probably do about 50,000 samples a year through our lab. And those are for regulatory compliance, but also for adjustment at the treatment plant and day-to-day. So we've done a multitude of short-term measures to deal with this, including reducing age of the water, because as the chlorine interacts with the organic matter and they form, if you can shorten the time that it takes from the water to get from that initial reaction to the tap, that can help as well. We do flushing in that regard too, where I think if you're here in the summer in Springfield, you see us running hydrants. That's for water quality. So things like that. We've also adjusted our coagulants, so some of the chemicals used in the drinking water treatment. We adjust those on a daily basis in terms of dosing and the actual type of coagulants that we use to help maximize and optimize our reduction of organics.
Professor, given that rainwater can drive this or snowmelt can drive this, is this something that we see that's cyclical? At this time of year, we would see an increase in this type of reaction in the water?
You're right. In fact, in order for this reaction to occur, you have to have organic compounds that are naturally occurring in the raw water source. Naturally occurring. They come from plants, terrestrial plants, trees, and they end up in the reservoir. They're very low concentrations. You don't always see them. It's not obvious that they're there, but they are there. And they're not harmful at all. They become potentially harmful when they react with the chlorine that we add to form to disinfect the water.
We're messing this up.
So we, but in fact, if you go back 100 years ago, there used to be broad death in cities due to waterborne diseases like cholera, typhoid, typhus, and we've been very successful at almost totally eliminating waterborne diseases in this country and around the world as a result of adding chlorine.
What other adjustments or shifts, as you said, you know, you're kind of changing water treatment on a day-to-day basis. What other changes or adjustments might you make at this time of year?
So I think there's a couple things, just kind of dovetailing in what the professor said, is that watershed is really important when you talk about the organic. So we manage about 16,000 acres of forest, and we manage that forest. It's fairly dynamic when you think about it. So we have active forestry programs, harvesting programs to make healthy forests. Healthy forests makes for really good raw water quality. So that's one of
those forests are surrounding the reservoir,
correct,
which is in turn coming to the city, and we're drinking that water.
Right, and that's where the organic materials are washing in from. So it's the bed of the forest, essentially, where the water is filtering through.
People might think, you're talking about water. Why is he talking about forests all of a sudden?
It's really an important piece, and I think you see a lot of communities trying to get funding to buy up the land around their watersheds, and there's a reason for that. Source water protection is a key element in controlling your organics and other elements to water as well. And then, you know, we've partnered with University of Massachusetts on several things, benchtop and pilot studies on optimizing organics removal as we move into longer term planning for how are we going to change our treatment plant to meet modern technology. I think a lot of utilities, including us, are dealing with plants that are sometimes 50 or even 100 years old, and technology has changed so rapidly, even month to month now. So a lot of this, and the regulations have changed as well. So you're dealing with old technology and plants with regulations that change every couple years. And so, you know, we seem to be chasing all the time regulations and technology. We can measure things now that 20 years ago we didn't even know existed, including THMs or disinfection byproducts and HAAs.
Just quickly, I know the testing was kind of March through December. You came out with this information, letting the public know that you saw this increase. When's the next time you'll test the water? What's the state of the water now?
So, well, again, we test the raw water every day to kind of track and trend what's happening with the organics. We'll have another quarterly sampling in March. And, you know, we're hopeful that the organics will calm down. So we keep track of that daily in raw water quality to see what the trend is. A lot of that has to do with things that are out of our hands, snow melt, rainfall, environmental conditions in the watershed.